So I am going to be talking about acute subdural hematoma secondary to aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage, and this is a national perspective using the inpatient national database. Let me move forward. So subdural hematomas caused by rupture of a cerebral aneurysm are rare and are often, because of being rare, associated with delayed diagnosis and treatment. Literature has reported 2 to 10% of aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhages present with a simultaneous subdural hematoma. This is an example of a subdural hematoma from a periculosal ACA aneurysmal rupture, as you can see here. Another example of a cortical MCA aneurysm, as you can see on the angiogram, causing a subdural hematoma. There are only 29 cases of subdural hematoma secondary to aneurysmal rupture that have been reported with no evidence of subarachnoid or intracerebral blood. In an autopsy series looking at ruptured intracranial aneurysms, 8% were shown to have some subdural blood with subarachnoid hemorrhage, and only 3% were pure subdural hematomas with no evidence of subarachnoid blood. So in a sense, pure or primary subdural hematoma without subarachnoid or ICH continues to be case reportable. In this very interesting study that looked at concomitant subarachnoid hemorrhages and subdural hematomas, they found that the posterior communicating artery and the middle cerebral artery lead to about 30% of these, followed closely by the anterior communicating artery and then other smaller cortical aneurysms. So our aim was to study the demographic presentations and the outcomes of concomitant non-traumatic subdural hematoma in the setting of an aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage using the National Inpatient Database. So the National Inpatient Database is the largest all-payer inpatient care database in the United States with more than 7 million hospital stays. Weighted, it estimates for more than 35 million hospitalizations nationally. Its large sample size is very ideal for developing national estimates of a disease, and especially useful for rare conditions, uncommon treatments, and special populations. So this was a retrospective cohort study. The National Inpatient Database was queried from January 2012 to September 2015. The last quartile of 2015 was not used because the ICD code, the way the coding is done, changed at that point of time. Patients with aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhages and subdural hemorrhages were identified using ICD-9 codes. So the inclusion criteria were hospitalizations for both ruptured aneurysms as designated by code ICD-9430 for subarachnoid hemorrhage and cerebral aneurysms together to assure that the patients who had subarachnoid hemorrhages were actually aneurysmal. Only those patients who also had this second code for cerebral aneurysms, 437.3, were included. Non-traumatic subdural hemorrhages were identified using this specific ICD code 432.1. All hospital admissions that were coded for trauma, so traumatic subarachnoid hemorrhage or traumatic subdural hematomas, were excluded. The groups were finally dichotomized into bad outcome and good outcome based on their discharge. So if they were discharged home or they were sent to inpatient rehab or home health aid was provided to them, those were considered the good outcome group, and those that went to nursing home or died were considered the bad outcome group. So a total of 10,075 patients with both cerebral aneurysms and subarachnoid were included. Of these, 335 cases also had concomitant subdural hematomas, and 9740 of the group had no evidence of subdurals. So this is looking at the trend of our subdural hematomas from 2012 to the first three quartiles of 2015. And the percentage of subdural hematoma continues to be somewhere between 2.5% to 4.3%. This number may actually be higher because the last quartile of 2015 was not included. An analysis looking at the subarachnoid hemorrhage alone group versus the subarachnoid and subdural combined, when we looked at all the demographic differences in the two groups, nothing approached significance. We did look for age, male, race, payer types, and APDRG, basically, which characterizes hospital admissions into minor to extreme based on their existing disease morbidity scores. So somebody who has other medical comorbidities would end up having a higher APDRG risk mortality score. As we expect, all of these were looked at and there were no significant differences seen in this population. We also looked at disease prevalence for most vascular risk factors and some other medical comorbidities in the two groups, and none of these approached significance, meaning that the patients coming in with this presentation had the similar baseline set of comorbidities. When we did look at the discharge disposition, important thing to note is that there was a 12% increase in the number of patients who died in the subdural and subarachnoid group combined, and only 16% of them were discharged home. So when we dichotomized into good outcome versus bad outcome, you can see that the patients with both subarachnoid and subdural had a significantly higher rate of bad outcome as compared to only aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhages. So there was overall nearly a 3.5% incidence of acute subdural hematomas in patients presenting with non-traumatic aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhages. Patients with concomitant STH and subarachnoid hemorrhage had a 24% mortality as compared to the 12% mortality in the subarachnoid-only group. 59% of patients in the concomitant group had a poor outcome. And this was based on the higher rates of death and nursing home admissions in this population. So this is so far the largest demographic study looking at concomitant subdural and aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhages. And this helps us by providing us important information about outcomes for these patients. Possible mechanisms of the concomitant subdural hematoma and subarachnoid may be adherence of an aneurysm to the local arachnoid granulations, and then when it bleeds, it leads to an arachnoid tear. Or if the hemorrhage happens under high pressure, it can lead to a pia arachnoid rupture and extravasation of blood into the subarachnoid space. As we expect, more superficial, like distal ACA, are more prone to rupture into the subarachnoid space. This is a systematic review that had looked at the outcomes of subarachnoid and subdurals, and they had found poor prognosis nearly two-thirds of the time. Our study, which is so far the largest study looking at concomitant STH and aneurysmal subarachnoid, found 59% poor outcomes, which is also nearly two-thirds. A small limitation of the study is that it looks at population level data and a lot of individual characteristics cannot be extracted. And because we were focused on including only aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhages, our coding methodology was to look for patients with both cerebral aneurysms and SAH. So we may have excluded a few patients that had the code for subarachnoid but did not have a code for cerebral aneurysms. In conclusion, patients with subarachnoid and subdural concomitantly seem to have a poorer prognosis, and this information can be useful for counseling and prognostication for such patients. Thank you.
Thank you.